Welcome back, WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and WNST, and Baltimore Positive. It is almost Orioles season around here. I know we got some turtle fever. I know the Ravens are a little bit of in a holding pattern with the CBA, and we'll get on the free agency next week as well. Luke Jones, I dare I say it's baseball season in March. I mean, my Masson doesn't tell me that, but whatever is going on down in Sarasota right now, where it's picking up free agents off the scrap heap, but certainly the Trey Mancini situation sits front and center for anyone who likes Trey or has watched him play. I know you have a bit of a relationship with him from your press days, and I don't, but he seems like the most likable guy that's put on an Oriole hat in years. And now there's this mysterious thing going on, and I think anybody who is an Oriole fan is certainly interested in this, engaged in this, but then there's the privacy part of all of this, and just sort of this feels like it's a serious thing, right?
There's a lot of unknown with this. I think, you know, with my opportunity to talk to a couple people down in Sarasota over the course of the weekend, I don't think this is something that's being hidden as much as there's just a lot of unknown right now. And when there's unknown, and I think anyone can relate to this, whether it's you yourself or someone in your inner circle that you care about, when there is a possibility of something potentially serious and when you're going under or you're undergoing a medical procedure that's not baseball related, I think Trey Mancini is entitled to some privacy, at least until they know for sure what they're dealing with. Now, I mean, let's call a spade a spade. I don't want to speculate, but at the same time, he's not undergoing a medical procedure for nothing. You know, I don't think this is something where it's cut and dried what it is and no big deal and he's out a week. And then, you know, I think there's some concern that it could be something a little more serious, and that's why there is some privacy at work here, and that's why you heard some of the comments you heard from some of the players over the weekend. Now, that said, I don't think that means anyone should be completely panicked or in absolute fear about it, but I think Trey Mancini, who did take to Twitter on Sunday evening, I saw that, and you know, thanked everyone for their support, their thoughts and prayers, and he alluded to the fact that once there's a little more clarity over the next few days, he's willing to share what's going on. But in the meantime, he's not with the team, and he's taking care of whatever this medical situation is. We do know he had been under the weather, and I know even early last week, was quipping. I mean, people were, I think some of his teammates in the clubhouse were, not making light of it, but saying, "Hey, do you have the coronavirus?" And, it wasn't as though he was deathly ill in his bed for 5 days, but he hadn't been feeling well. And I think, they're certainly trying to see what exactly is causing that.
Well, in my world, right? I mean, we're coming up on the 6th anniversary of my wife, showing up at the hospital and saying, "I don't feel good." To, "Hey, you're in the hospital for 45 days, you're bald, you're fighting for your life." So, I know how quickly things can turn. And when you hear testing or when you hear sort of the nebulous sort of, "We don't know what it is," that's always frightening, So, and obviously the baseball part of this is that it's spring training and it's a time of hope and all that stuff. And we're watching all of these players, and there's quite frankly not a whole lot of hope for the Orioles to begin with, but he is the one piece of hope, right? I mean, him and Means are the two guys who are like, "Hey, these are the good players on the team. These are the real Major League Baseball players," as opposed to the Quad A guys. And here's a guy that we thought, and I know for fans, he's such a likable guy. The thought is we want him around when the team's good again. That's a whole different discussion from where we are right now, where, this kid is having a medical issue and we're all scratching our head and saying, "I wonder what it is," right?
Yeah, I mean, of course there's curiosity. Of course there's a sense of wanting to know exactly what he's dealing with. I think the team feels that. I think, you're going through this process now, and a lot of it is just trying to rule things out. And until you can rule certain things out that are more serious, that go without saying, I mean, we all, either individually or we know someone who's dealt with serious medical concerns or ailments or diseases, whatever it might be, there is concern. And it goes so far beyond baseball. I mean, Trey Mancini's going to be 28 next week, and he's a mentor on this team. I mean, guys like Austin Hayes, who are just breaking into the major leagues, and guys that you're hoping could be part of that next Orioles winner, however long it might be. You know, Trey Mancini is someone that they look up to. He's someone who's been an ambassador for the organization at a time where they don't really have a face of the franchise. I mean, the closest thing they had to that for a long time was Adam Jones, and you know, he's now in Japan. He's long gone at this point. We know
and probably wearing a mask, from what I understand, yes.
Yeah, playing in empty stadiums in Japan. But I think, you know, Trey Mancini is someone who has been active in the community. He took over for Adam Jones, his Purple Tailgate, did that. He has a relationship with Mo Gabba, who many people in the community know as a super sports fan. So, I mean, he's someone who's been a face of the organization at a time where you still need that, and there's still value to that. As much as this is not anything close to a winning team at this point, that doesn't mean Trey Mancini's not a winning individual, and that speaks to who he is on the field, but it also speaks to who he is in the clubhouse and in the community. So I think there's definitely, you know, there's a lot of concern. There's a lot of uneasiness until you know exactly what he's dealing with, and when you're undergoing a non-baseball medical procedure, as he's going to this week, that's going to prompt people to speculate and wonder and worry and, you know, panic and not knowing what it is. But I think in the meantime, you know, Trey Mancini kind of said it best on Sunday night when he went on his Twitter and just thanked everyone and said, hey, I'll be ready to talk about this when I have a better idea of what's going on over the next few days. I'm looking forward to recovering and getting back on the baseball field soon. When that's going to be, who cares at this point in relation to what's really important is his overall health as a human being and making sure he's okay in that way. So, you know, for a club that's getting ready for opening day, a little over 2 weeks away, hard to believe.
Isn't that crazy?
Oh, it's crazy. I mean, these leagues.
We started the clocks back the other day. What's going on around here, man? I mean, 70 degrees on Monday. It's nuts.
Oh, right. And late March opening day. I mean, that's another discussion. But it's definitely strange in that way. But for these guys in that clubhouse, the coaching staff, to have to be worrying about Trey Mancini. I mean, it's not about baseball. It's about making sure that he's healthy and he'll be back when he's back.
Well, it makes these 5-5 split squad tie games against the Yankees and Tampa even more meaningless than they already are, right? Like, I mean, yeah. We're all trying to figure out what the value of this spring training was from a fan's perspective. I mean, Trey Mancini aside, Luke, if I said to you right now, bring me up to speed on the Orioles. Well, they're not on TV. You're sort of half following them off the internet, all the stuff we bitched about last week. But more than that, now this becomes like the centerpiece of the best kid on the team, maybe the best person on the team, a guy everybody likes, having these medical issues in the middle of all of this. And you get all these young kids trying to make the team. There is sort of the baseball news of, like, we are 2 weeks out on opening day. Who's coming north with the team? Who's gonna be running through the bullpen in center field 2 weeks from now? I don't think most of Baltimore knows who these players are.
I mean, I think they know who a few are. But, yeah, I mean, if you're asking someone to fill out the 26-man roster, and, yeah, it's strange saying 26, but that's where we are now. Expanded to 26. Can have
Man, how many times am I going to slip on that? Probably as many times as I've called the Chargers San Diego, right?
Right. How about the rule with relievers have to face a minimum of three batters? Jason Stark did a great piece on The Athletic over the weekend about, you know, talking to managers, how that's going to change strategy and alter strategy, and are we going to see more intentional walks with lefties not wanting to face a righty slugger? I mean, so, yeah, well, there will be time for that. But yeah, to your overall point, sure, there's a lot of unknown. I think they're certainly intrigued to see Austin Hayes, who's expected to be the opening day center fielder, barring an injury or anything like that. There's intrigue about Hunter Harvey, what his role is going to be in the bullpen. He was a little late making his spring debut, was a little under the weather, but he's been out there and he's looked good in his couple spring outings. I think there's a lot of interest in Ryan Mountcastle, who is probably going to start the year at Norfolk, but is probably not going to be there all that terribly long. So, you know, there's question about him, and you know, beyond that, you know, you look at an Anthony Santander, who looked really good at times last year. How's he going to look? Kind of penciled in. You would think, assuming the shoulder's healthy, as the opening day left fielder, but with Trey Mancini and his status being up in the air, what does that mean for their outfield? Does that create a spot for an extra outfielder, someone like Dwight Smith Jr., who I don't think was an absolute lock to make the roster? Does that put him on the roster more comfortably? Does that open up a spot for someone else? But to your overall point, there's still more placeholders than prospects on this team right now. We know that. That's just the reality of where they are. I do think 2020 is more interesting from the standpoint of starting to see some more of these guys. Hayes is here. Harvey is here. Mountcastle will be here at some point, probably by summer, I would say, at the latest. So,
but there's also some of yesterday's names, like the Cedric Mullins and the Chance Cisco types, that at least when they're running around in Sarasota, I'm like, they believed in that guy at one point, right? They thought guy was the guy, right?
Right, right. And that's where, someone like a Cedric Mullins is a perfect example of, he's someone who probably not going to be on the roster, but with the Mancini situation, that opens up a spot potentially for someone like him. And he's on the 40-man, so you have to option him anyway. So there is interest in guys like that. You mentioned Chance Cisco, who, a couple years ago, he was never viewed like Adley Rutschman is viewed, and he was never viewed like Matt Wieters back in the day, but there was thought that Chance Cisco was the catcher of the future. And at this point, doesn't really feel that way, but that doesn't mean he can't be a useful, serviceable major leaguer.
Yeah, I was wondering if he's going to be a major league catcher, because I've heard way too much about him to not be, right? There's something about the Oriole pipeline and the Oriole way, and that they've stunk for the most part, other than for a couple of years, where it's always been about the next Jeffrey Hammonds or the next Alex Ochoa or the next Jim Fuller or the next Drungo Hazewood. That's what you have when you're a last-place team, and perennially a last-place team. Over 25 years, the Orioles have spent a whole lot more time at the bottom than the top, and there's always another Chance Cisco, or always the Hunter Harvey's another name that's going around. Dylan Bundy was a name we heard about for 5 years before we ever knew what he looked like. So that's part of this. We're going to be that way with Rutschman until he shows up, like we were with Wieters until he showed up the night of the rainbow, right?
Yeah, and there's some of that with every team. Every team hypes up their prospects, and in many cases more so than Baseball America or Baseball Prospectus or Fangraphs. So there's always going to be some of that. But, the good news for the Orioles is that, Rutschman's a given, but lots of people like Grayson Rodriguez, lots of people like D.L. Hall, lots of people still like Ryan Mountcastle, even if there's some question about where exactly he's going to play. He's hit at every level, and he's still pretty young. So even if there's some question about his ability to draw walks and plate discipline, but he's produced and he's hit for power. So they have guys that other people in baseball like. It's just a matter of developing more of them. And, they're making strides, especially on the pitching side, position player side. They still have work to do. There's no question about that. But I think starting in 2020, but more so as we get into 2021, 22, 23, you're going to start to see the fruits of that a little bit more. Now, I'm not guaranteeing that's adding up to making the playoffs or getting to a World Series 4 years from now, but you saw progress being made in the minor leagues last year. The strikeout total spiked. The ERAs looked better. They had some winning teams down on the farm, so that was good to see as well, but they still have a lot of work to do. There's no question about that. And in 2020 on the pitching side, we'll probably see Keegan Aiken at some point, assuming he doesn't come north with the club. I think another guy to keep an eye on is Bruce Zimmerman. I think Dean Kramer, who was part of the Manny Machado deal, he's someone that I've liked and I've really been watching the last year and a half. I think he's got a chance to perhaps be in Baltimore later in 2020. So they're at the point now where there are some guys at Triple A. Yusniel Diaz on the position player side, he needs some more seasoning at Norfolk. He needs to stay healthy more than anything else after an injury-plagued 2019. But They've got some guys at Norfolk.
See, all these names, they're all no one in the audience, these are not the first time anybody's heard these names, but I don't know that Yuzneel Diaz, anybody would know what he looks like unless they've been the buoy lately, right? I mean, like,
yeah.
And that name meant something 2 summers ago, and at some point, the Dean Kramers and the all those names that were, I will call them the Duquette kids, right? The Duquette rummage sale that they had around here when they were, you know, giving away first-round draft picks to the Braves, right? You'd love to see something come out of that more than the Jacobo Sequoias of, you know, previous years, right? I mean, I'm going back 2 decades, but
sure.
You remember the names of everybody in the Earl Williams deal, you know? You do.
No question. You think back to
Curt Schilling and Brady Anderson and all that, yes.
I was going to say, B.J. Surhoff and Melvin Mora being...
Pete Harnish.
Or Mike Bordick for Melvin Mora, you know? Like, you got to think about some of those that didn't work out so well, but... And look, I bring up those names, and that's not to say that all those guys are going to make it, but if we're talking about this team starting to show some progress at the major league level, not necessarily in the wins-loss department, because I don't think you're going to see that in 2020, but you start to see a few more individuals where you say, okay, that's a guy who has a chance to be part of the next contender. That's a guy who has a chance to be part of the next playoff team. That's a guy who could settle into the back of their rotation. That's a guy, you know, Hunter Harvey could be their closer over the next few years. And who knows, he might be a guy who pitches really well and gets dealt at some point in the next 12 months, and you add more to the farm. So, I mean, it's still a moving target at this point as far as a rebuild, and it's not imminent that they're turning the corner. Believe me, I'm not suggesting anything like that. But if you can start to identify some more guys coming to Baltimore, playing every day, pitching every 5 days, settling into a meaningful bullpen role, and guys that are young enough and promising enough, then this thing starts to become a little more interesting in that regard. I mean, we're still in the placeholder phase. I think now is a critical time for guys like Anthony Santander, Rio Ruiz, guys, Chance Sisko is a perfect example, guys that, hey, this season might be your last best chance to really say that you want to be part of something that could be decent 2, 3, 4 years down the road. So those guys, it's critical for them. This is the time, Rio Ruiz, if you want to prove you're an everyday third baseman in the major leagues, this season might be your last best chance to do that. Chance Sisko, you want to at least be the number two catcher, and maybe be Adley Rutschman's backup in a couple years, and be a guy that maybe isn't known for his defense but can hit and provide some value that way. You know, this year might be your last best chance to do that, because if you don't do it this year, Mike Elias might be willing to move on. And I thought it was interesting, not to transition too much, but the fact that the Orioles sent back both Rule 5 pitchers on Friday, which I thought was interesting from a standpoint of how this team just hoarded Rule 5 picks and played shorthanded under Dan Duquette, yet...
I had to look up Nestor's last name. I thought it was Garcia.
Cortez,
but it was
right,
Cortez.
Right.
I thought it was Torres, and now that's the flautist, but Nestor Cortez. I did look that up. By the way, the reason I looked that up, we are in spring training here, so we can have a breezy conversation. My dear friend Russ Letra, who is... I went to... Went to Dundalk with Russ, but Russ was my Eagles season ticket holder buddy back in the 80s when Buddy Ryan was coaching the Eagles and Randall was running around and Baldinger was down on the O-line playing on the concrete at the vet. And he sent me a picture. He was out in spring training in Surprise, Arizona, and he was right behind the dugout, and there is an Aparicio. There is a Miguel Aparicio, who is an outfielder in the Texas Rangers organization. So there's a kid who wears number 85 for the Texas Rangers in a blue jersey, and it said Aparicio on it. And I thought, man, we've had a Nestor and an Aparicio in the big leagues here the last couple of years. It's good, man. It's good. I'm pulling for this kid to get to Arlington is what I'm doing.
Oh, no doubt. And, I mean, spring is a great time of year where you see some of these names. And, I mean, the Yankees – coming to Sarasota on Sunday, you saw guys with numbers in the 80s playing, and I mean, it's.
Is there any? I mean, we've had a Luke Scott. Has there been a Luke Jones in Major League Baseball?
I don't think. I've never really thought about it. I mean, there's certainly there've been.
I mean, you have a name like some at some point some some dude's going to dribble a basketball for Kent State, and his name's going to be Luke Jones,
and he's
right?
going to be a much greater athlete than I ever was. But, hey, I'll say this much, though. The Orioles, you know, about 10 years ago at this point, it's hard to say it's been 10 years ago, but they had Luke Scott and they had Adam Jones, so you mash those two together and you have Luke Jones. There you go.
Miguel Aparicio played outfield for the Hickory Crawdads last year, according to Baseball America. So, and he is Venezuelan, so he does not look like me, though. I can claim nothing here. He's left-handed, which makes me like him even more. So there you have it. Dude hit 297. No, he didn't hit 297. What did he hit? He hit 251 last year with 12 bombs and 49 ribs at low A. So, you know, have at it. In a Sally.
There you go.
We'll see
How
if we can get him
he?
Up. He's 20.
How old is he?
He's 20. This
okay,
guy.
20, so he's at low single A. Okay, I mean, that's potential there. So, yeah, that's good to see.
Well, I'm pulling for Miguel Aparicio in the Rangers organization.
No, hey, at this point in time, you want to be pulling for minor leaguers. That's about all Orioles fans. I mean, that's just reality right now. I mean, save for a few guys at the major league level, I mean, that's still where the Orioles are in this rebuild. We knew that.
I'm trying to figure out if Miguel Aparicio could ever play a game at like Salisbury or Frederick or Bowie, which would get me to go.
Yeah, you'll have to map it out.
I'm monitoring his career, young man. I've got my eye on you now, number 85 for the Hickory Crawdads.
Yeah, a little plan out a little minor league road trip. How about that?
There you go. Go see my namesake. Luke Jones, you know, he has no peer in all of this. He's got Ravens this week, Orioles this week, certainly some Terps on our mind as we get up on the Big Ten tournament later on in the week. And opening day, 2 weeks away. Who would have thought it, Luke? You ready for hot dogs already?
I am. I mean, look, I'm not expecting a very entertaining baseball season from a win-loss perspective. That much is stating the obvious, but I am looking forward to seeing some of the young guys that we mentioned. And I'll say this, you know, we joked about it last week, and I'm still not believing, and I'm still not buying into spring training stats, but Chris Davis continues to hit, and he has 2 strikeouts and 23 plate appearances. Nestor, I would say over the last 2.5 years when this thing is really completely fallen apart for him, I don't know if you could find a 23 plate appearance stretch where he only struck out twice. So I don't know. I'm still more inclined to think Jake Fox when I see that, but I'll give him credit. He's hit and he's produced in the spring, and the longer it keeps going on, the more I'm curious to see how he looks come late March at Camden Yards. But it's right around the corner now. It's hard to believe that baseball season is a little over 2 weeks away.
Have you ever heard of the Down East Wood Ducks?
I have not.
They're a real team. I thought this was like an Onion joke. It's not. They're a minor league team. They are the High A in the Carolina League.
Okay.
They play in Kinston, North Carolina.
Okay,
and they are named for the local colorful waterfowl, the Down East Wood Duck. It is.
I knew there was a team in Kinston. I did not know the Wood Ducks.
They are the Down East. The name is Down East. 2 words, like down the ocean, Down East Wood Ducks. The 4 words, Down East Wood Ducks. They are the High. And you wonder why they're trying to close down minor league teams here, Luke. next up would be the Frisco Rough Riders, and I know that's Frisco, Texas,
right.
Hometown of a certain former linebacker of the Ravens who's now a coach, and the Nashville Sounds would be the next place up. So he'll almost be in the big leagues with the Orioles by the time he gets to Nashville Sounds. So I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to get to see Miguel Aparicio play, but I've done a little bit of research, and I think I need a Down East Wood Ducks hat before it's all over with.
There are some great minor league ball caps out there. I mean, there really are. I remember when I was a kid, I had an Erie Seawolves hat that I really liked.
Probably saw that somewhere in a John Thorne novel
or
something.
My grandfather was big into, you know, collecting, and you know, he's given me some great collectible pieces over the years. I mean, he passed away 10 years ago, but he gave me some great pieces, and for a time, he was into minor league ball caps, and got me a couple. I had an Erie Seawolves cap, and I had a Chattanooga Lookouts hat, which was a really cool-looking logo as well. So, yeah, there are some fun team names, some head-scratching team names for that matter as well. But
well, the Durham Bulls became, you know, sort of famous when the movie happened.
They're the Yankees, right? I mean, they're the legacy with Crash Davis and Nuke DeLuge.
baseball season. The movies will be better than the season, from what I understand. You can find Luke Jones, Baltimore Luke, out on Twitter and LinkedIn and Instagram and Facebook and all the places that we travel. The buyatoyota.com audio vault is our repository for all things Terps this week, as well as getting you ready for free agency in the NFL next week. Tons of Baltimore positive stuff ahead. Sit down with Sheila Dixon this week. She is the final mayoral candidate that we have spoken to. We were very tough on Sheila. She deserved it. And you can find all of that at Baltimore Positive. Hold April the 14th. We're doing something very, very special to celebrate the one-year anniversary of Baltimore Positive. I'm wearing my Liberty Pure hat. We're drinking clean water around here, courtesy of our friend Doug Workman. And you can hear that segment we did with Matt Stover up there, learning more about clean water around here as well. And I've got my Terps Magma Lamp here, courtesy of our friends at Sporticulture. Maryland, we're all behind you. Indianapolis, late night, Friday night. We'll get the brackets out on Sunday, and hopefully the Terps are playing somewhere local, and hopefully have a good weekend. I am Nestor. We are WNST.net, AM 1570, and WNST, Towson, Baltimore. And we never stop talking Baltimore sports.